good to see each of you this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Finally, we got this fixed. Don't it sound better? Amen. That I don't have to be prohibited in just a little small space. We are blessed this morning to have some distinguished visitors with us. Amen. And it would be remiss of me if I did not give them an opportunity to just say hello, how you doing? We haven't seen them in quite some time. And especially, I'm going to start with they used to be here a part of our family. He was a deacon, she was a part of the mother's board. And they were a blessing to our church family. The Lord used them. He works with Starbucks, still with Starbucks. And it was unfortunate for us. The Lord moved him away. And who knows? God does some strange things. The Lord just might give him a circular type of destiny and bring him right back here again. Wouldn't it be ironic? Brother and Sister Brockman, stand up. And Yvonne, stand up, Yvonne. You remember when Yvonne was here, she was about what age? About 7, 8, 9. And how old are you now, Yvonne? Y'all are getting old. I'm like I said, about my age. She's going to be a beautiful young lady. Brother Brockman, where is Dennis? Junior. Is Junior? Yeah, where is he at? Western Illinois. Well, tell them that we sent our love. But Brockman, you want to come up here and just on behalf of the family, give a salutation?
Amen. Amen. Giving honor to God, to Pastor Bonner, Sister Bonner, her absence, the pulpit, all my brothers and sisters in Christ. We just thank God for he has been good. And choir, I tell you, that sound great, and I almost lost it on that second song. So I don't know about you, but when I see Jesus, I got a grandma and I got a grandpa who I want to see, Sister Travis, but when I see Jesus, I'm going to shout. Amen. So we thank God for this opportunity. It was Parents Weekend at my son's college. He's a junior now. So we went by, visited with him. He only gave us breakfast. That's all he gave us. Amen. And then we came on and said, while we're here, we're going to come back home. And this has been, Pleasant Green was the longest place we worship in our marriage, in our 22 years marriage. We had moved around. So this is home to us. Amen. And we appreciate, amen. We appreciate you all allowing Pastor Bonner and Sister Bonner to come and fellowship with us about 2 years ago, and we had a great time in the Lord as he brought the word to our church. So we do bring you greetings from New Community Baptist Church under the leadership of Servant George Rayford in Aurora, Illinois. So we just thank God, and for the members, there are certain things that still have not changed. And for those who do not know Brother and Sister Brockman, Deacon Brockman still cannot sing. Amen. Amen. There's certain things have not changed. Amen. But I still praise the Lord. Amen. So we thank God, and Pastor's right. When we left here, I was the regional director for Starbucks in Chicago. And from there, I actually went to Washington, D.C., and I commuted. My family stayed in Chicago where I commuted for 15 months, came back in May to take on another regional director position. And then just last week, I thank God that he elevated me again on another promotion. Amen. That I would now be supporting the entire U.S. So I'll be traveling all over the United States supporting our 7,700 stores. So I just thank God for what he has done, what he continues to do. He is an awesome God. Amen. And we just thank God for Pleasant Green. We love Pleasant Green. Amen. We just love you all. And I asked DJ one time, I said, you've been to 4 different churches. And I just was curious. I said, so which one did you really impacted, Evan, your life? And he mentioned here at Pleasant Green and the young people that he had a chance to minister with in the young ministry. So thank you all to see young men over there playing. Just thank you all for what you have done for the Brockmans. We love Pleasant Green. We love you. We love our pastor and our first lady, these ministers. Our history, if ever written, cannot be written without mentioning Pleasant Green Missionary Baptist Church in St. Louis, Missouri. We just thank God. We thank God for planting us here when he did. And we often said that there is a season, a reason, or a lifetime. And we feel that this relationship would definitely be a lifetime. So we just give honor unto God. We thank you, Pleasant Green. We love you all. And we will be back. Amen. We'll try not to. I think it's 2.5 years. The sanctuary looks beautiful. Amen. Looks beautiful. And I was watching CNN and looked up and saw John. I didn't want to see him on CNN. Amen. But it's good to see him. So we've been praying for you all. We are doing some work in the city here, my organization, and we're actually building a couple of stores in Ferguson to support the community. So you'll be hearing more about that on our way of trying to give back and support the causes of what's going on in America. So we are now going into places that we typically would not build stores, and we're actually building stores to create jobs for young people. And we have an initiative, real quick if I may say, what we call Opportunity 100K. We started last month in Chicago, where we had about 3,000 young people ages of 16 to 24 who do not go to school and do not have jobs. And 600 of them left with a job that day. So we'll continue that effort in many cities. We're going to Phoenix, Arizona, which is our next city, and continue to that. So thank Pastor, thank you for this time. We love you, and God bless you all.
Giving thanks to God who had headed the church, and to my good friend and this great pastor, Pastor Barner, and the other priest brethren of the gospel. It's just good to be here. The Lord looked and made us to come again to visit our sister. We come every chance we get. She's 93 or 94 years old, and we will have to visit her yesterday. And she sent her love to the pastor and the church. We are so grateful to be here. We're on our way down to Tennessee to start a week's revival tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. We solicit your prayers. We have 5 nights there in Tennessee, and ask you to pray for us. And also, I have my sister with me. She flew up from Tennessee, and by the way of Virginia, I'm gonna ask my sister to stand. We'll be driving back tomorrow. My granddaughter came with me, but she said, "No, Reverend, I'm not going today." Well, I figured that. So my wife not here. I ask you to pray for my mother-in-law, because she's a sick lady. And I'm asking your prayer, because my wife had to spend many nights with her. So I'm asking you to pray for her. And all of you know my nephew, Brother Stewart here, you know him, and we're here spending a night or two with him, and we have had a glorious time in the Lord, and we want to thank this pastor again for yielding and giving me this opportunity to come and say hello to Pleasant Green.
What always makes you feel good when permanent friendships. There's some friendships that are just temporary, and then others, they last. And when you see those lasting friendships, and of course, to have a friend doesn't necessarily mean that you have to be in communication with them, consistently, day in, day out. Maybe you may not talk to them over a span of 3 or 4 years, but you know that they are there. And whenever you call, you know that they're there with words of encouragement. So we are blessed to have Brockmans and Reverend Pearson as permanent friends. Amen. And good to see Valerie's sister. I haven't seen her in about 4 or 5 years lately. Long, I don't know. Anyway, time is so elusive. I don't try to keep up with it, because the more I keep up with time, then the more I think about it in terms of how time is wearing on me. So, you know, like all of us, we try to continue it, not as old as we are, you know that some other things are coming in. So God bless you. God keep you. I want you to open your Bible with me to the book of Genesis. For those of you who have not been with us, we are in some messages in the book of Genesis with the patriarchs. We started out with Isaac, from Isaac to Jacob. And now we are in the story of Joseph. And as you know, if you don't know, that Joseph takes up more chapters in the latter part of Genesis than his father Jacob, his grandfather Isaac, and his great-great-grandfather Abraham. And that's because that scripture tells us, and how many of you ever heard of the term type of Christ? Have you ever heard of that term, type of Christ? Joseph is a type of Christ. We'll get into that later on. If you have Genesis chapter 40, and last Sunday we looked at chapter 39, right? Chapter 39 has 23 verses. Ironically, chapter 40 has 23 verses. Now, I don't know why. I don't know whether it's a coincidence or whether that was by design. But in this 40th chapter, and let me use this as a tag for our thinking, freedom comes at a price. Freedom comes at a price. I'm going to start out by giving you the narrative in the whole 40th chapter. And then we're going to move from there to look at some truths lessons that we can lift out of this drama. In chapter 39 of Genesis, Joseph has been sold into slavery by his 11 brothers. And the reason why that they did it is because of their hatred and disdain for their younger brother. And Joseph was not all to blame. Jacob, his father, really did a lot of that and put him in bad light with his older brothers, because Jacob, we found out, favored Joseph and then put Joseph over his older brothers like a manager, like an overseer. And when by right, Reuben, who was the oldest, should have been put over the property and managing in terms of the other affairs of Jacob's family. But because Jacob loved Joseph, why? Because Joseph was the oldest son of Rachel. Who was Rachel? Rachel was Jacob's wife. Really, if his uncle Laban had treated him right, he wouldn't have had one wife, and that would have been Rachel. But because he got tricked, you know, we talk about when you try to trick somebody, beware, the boomerang will come back to you. You will be tricked. And his uncle tricked him, so he had to wait 7 years, he thought, for Rachel. Then he was given Leah, the older sister. Then he had to wait another 7 years to get the woman who was after his own heart. And Rachel, this is some historical background, Rachel died on their way to the land of Canaan, where she was giving birth to Joseph's youngest son, Benjamin. And because of this, that Jacob, I guess, saw in Joseph a lot of the woman where his heart was. I don't know, maybe he had eyes like his mother, mouth. You know how we talk about children, you know, they look like a parent. But whatever it was that he saw, it might have been his mannerisms also, but whatever he saw in Joseph, it somewhat bonded him in spirit with his son. And what he did, he went overboard by, really, he spoiled Joseph. He gave him a coat of many colors, which was a coat of authority. And a lot of things that he did, in fact, he would even verbally say it before his other sons that Joseph was his favorite son. So you know what type of life that put Joseph in as related to his brothers. So it's not uncommon, nor is it out of logic that his brothers hated their younger brother. Now, should they have hated him by the standards of God? No, but they did, because they were responding out of their emotion. And it's just the same thing, and I'm going to be doing a lot of digressing here, because I only have three truths that I'm going to lift up. But it's a funny thing about human nature. Even we as believers in Christ, even though the Word of God tells us that we are to love one another without partiality, still we allow the flesh to override the spirit. And we act like those that are unsaved. We act and we move in terms of with their thinking, their mannerisms, and their attitude. But anyway, Joseph sold into slavery. He's down in Egypt. And the narrator says that when he got in Egypt, he kept on repetitively enumerating the fact God was with Joseph. God was with Joseph. And Potiphar, who was the captain of the guards for Pharaoh, saw Joseph, and with God being with Joseph, I'm sure that Pharaoh saw something in this young man. So he bought him as a slave. And because Joseph was such a hard worker, and he watched him in terms of his managing, in terms of his idea of non-partiality, he put Joseph over his whole household, made him the estate manager, even over all of the other Egyptian slaves. Well, things were good for a while. And let me condense this. But Potiphar's wife, you can assume she was bored staying at home. She might have been an attractive woman, but whatever her problem was. When her eyes saw Joseph, and we're told by the narrator, Joseph was a handsome young man, tall, possibly, dark, and handsome. Anyway, she called herself flirting with Joseph. And we're told day in and day out, she was somewhat initiating innuendos, flirting remarks with him. And after a while, she decided that she would step up her flirting. So she started asking him, I want to go to bed with you. I want you to come and get in bed with me. Joseph kept on telling her no. And he always found a way out while the conversation was on that. But then finally, one day, when she might have sent all of the other slaves in other areas, but anyway, Joseph was doing his work and he was there alone by himself. she decided, I'm not going to ask him, but I'm going to grab him. And that's what she did. She grabbed him and she said, you're going to bed with me. And Joseph gave her two reasons why he couldn't, he wouldn't. First of all, he said, I will be betraying the trust to my master as well as you are betraying your husband. And then secondly, I will be letting my guard down and it will be hurting him. She paid that no attention. She grabbed him, she tried to seduce him. He got up, he started running. She grabbed his tunic, she ripped it off. Joseph fled. Then when her husband gets home, she tells him a lie that Joseph tried to rape her. And she was the initiator of all of this. And then she even implied to her husband, if you had not brought this Hebrew slave in our home, we would not be having this problem. And then she tried to get the other Egyptian slaves to side with her. You see what this Hebrew has done among us? We would not have had this problem if this had been an Egyptian slave. Anyway, Pharaoh, he acted as any normal husband would act, and he got angry, and he put Joseph not in the common prison, but he put him in the prison that Pharaoh had sequestered in terms of military prisoners and political prisoners. They call it the king's prison. And historians say that wherever he was quartered, it must not have been too far from where Potiphar was living, so Potiphar could keep an eye on him. Now, by law, when his wife alleged the allegation that Joseph had raped her, then the normal response would have been Potiphar would have executed Joseph immediately. So this lets us know that he loved the young. There was something in his heart, and it might have been deep down in his heart, he may not have even believed his wife. Because I have a feeling this wasn't the only incident for Sister Potiphar. No, this wasn't the only time. You know, she'd been flirting with some of those other slaves. But anyway, he put him in prison. The writer says, being put in prison, God was with Joseph. Now, look how God works in his sovereignty. Joseph is put into prison as a common what? Slave prisoner. But because God was with Joseph, what happened was this. The keeper of the prison saw in this young man something he didn't see in the other prisoners. So he put Joseph as manager over all of the prisoners in the prison. Isn't that strange? Joseph started managing the prison, and he is a prisoner. But it was because God was with Joseph. And whenever God is with you, I don't care what the circumstances are, what people try to do to destroy you or to knock you down. If God is for you, he's more than all the world and folk against you. Now, if you've never gone through that, see, you have to experience that to know what I'm talking about. If you never experience that, then you really don't understand that. And that's not just a religious platitude, but that is an experience of life. He puts him over prison. And as he puts him over prison, one day, Pharaoh got angry with his butler and his baker and put them in the same prison where Joseph was. God was with Joseph. Keep that statement in your mind. As God was with Joseph, one night the butler and the baker both had dreams. The same night, somewhat different dreams, but then there were similarities. So when they woke up the next morning, they were troubled. They were disturbed. So Joseph saw the sadness in their faces, and he said to them, he said, what's wrong? In essence, can I help you? And then they said, yeah, we had some disturbing dreams. And the Egyptian Empire was noted for their men of magic and their magicians to be able to interpret dreams. For they thought that dreams came from the subconscious mind. But they couldn't interpret these dreams because God was with Joseph. And Joseph said to them, I will try, but God is the only one who is an interpreter of dreams. And if he chooses, he can interpret the dream through me. So the butler said, well, I had a dream. And in my dream, there was a grapevine. And the grapevine had three branches that came forth from it. And each one of the branches had clusters of beautiful grapes. And in my dream, I saw myself getting these grapes, squeezing them, and pouring the juice into a cup. So he said, Joseph, what does this mean? Joseph said, well, the three branches indicate 3 days. In 3 days, Pharaoh is going to bring you out of this dungeon, and he's going to reinstate you in the position that you had. Now, in actuality, the word butler there really refers to, in Hebrew, a wine tester, which meant this, that whenever there was a drink of wine given or offered to Pharaoh, he had to drink it first to see whether it was poison or not. If he drank it and fell dead, then Pharaoh knew, I will not drink it. So he was the wine tester. But anyway, he was reinstated. Now, the baker said, and he saw how Joseph had interpreted the dream for the butler. So the baker said, well, I also had a dream last night. Well, what was your dream? He said that I dreamed that I had three baskets on top of my head. And the top basket, it had a lot of bread and goodies in it for Pharaoh. But then birds came and started eating out of that top basket. What does that mean, Joseph? Well, Joseph can give some good news to the baker. He said, well, again, the three baskets indicate 3 days. 3 days, Pharaoh is going to take you out of this prison. He's going to reinstate you. But the problem is, after he does, he's going to kill you and hang you. And then the birds are going to come and eat the flesh off of your bones. Sure enough, this is what happened to the baker. Pharaoh killed him. But the butler was reinstated in his position. Now, you got the story. Man, you got somewhat of a background. Now, are there any truths in this story? Because God doesn't tell stories for the fact that he's got nothing else to do but tell the story. God has a purpose. Like Jesus in the New Testament, when he told stories called parables, there were what? There were truths and principles and lessons to be what? Lifted up from those parables. Well, let me suggest three. You ready? Got your pen? Got your extra notebook? Because you're going to be writing about 4 or 5 pages. No, I'm just kidding. First of all, when we look at Joseph was a slave, right? But we are told that being a slave, he was a prosperous slave, and he was a successful slave. Now, when you look at that statement and put it juxtaposed to in terms of what a slave actually was, and you can go back 200 years ago to our great-great-grandparents in terms of when they were in slavery, slaves didn't own anything. They were chattel property of the master. Not only that, they had no rights. Whatever they were accused of, then whether they did it or not, they would have to accept their fate. Plus, there were no courts for them to appeal to. Let's parallel that with our ancestors when they were in slavery. Whether they were working in the master's house, whether they were working in the field. whatever somebody said about it, let me give you an example. Let's just say in the master's house, the master's gone. He's married. And he's got his wife there. And she sees a black slave. And let's just say he's a hulk. And he looks good. Muscles just popping out, even in his eyeball and everything. And she thinks to herself, and the husband doesn't have time to really give her the attention that she wants. Amen? So she sees this slave, and she starts to what? She starts to daydreaming. She starts to having fantasies in her mind. Boy, sure would be nice to be with this slave. Well, she plots and she schemes to find a way when her husband is gone, and maybe to put out the rest of the servants, and she grabs this slave. Now, he may not want it. He can't do what Joseph did. Well, he could, but then again, if he did, then when her husband got back home, she could also claim he tried to rape me, and then he would either be beat, hanged, or killed. So, in order to keep his life, what does he do? He what? He gives in. And in doing it, he creates a bigger problem than what he had. Because see, now, if he does it one time, and when she gets an urge, she's going to want it done over and over again, and she will blackmail him by saying, I'm going to tell my husband. Do you get the picture? You understand the precarious situation that a slave was in? And the same way it was then, the same way it was with Joseph. But God was with Joseph. Now, the answer to this prosperity and success of Joseph, let me give you a truth here that I lifted from this story. Prosperity and success do not depend upon circumstances, but upon the character and the attitude of the person in the circumstances. Does that make sense? Let me say it another way. You're going to always have in your life, from the cradle to the grave, there's going to always be something bad that's going to happen around you, whether it comes through your biological family, friends, your job, social gatherings. Sometimes it come through the church, amen. But wherever it comes, it lends itself to possibly attacking your faith, your spirit, your emotions, because that's where Satan wants to tear us down and to undermine the foundation of our faith, amen. But if you are strong in your faith and you stand on God's faithfulness in God's word, in spite of the circumstances and maybe all the hell that's going on around you, if you can remain positive like Joseph in your spirit and not allow it to get you down, because you see, Joseph could have become what? Bitter. He could have become angry. He knew he was innocent. He was falsely accused. He could have gotten angry with God and cursed God. He could have gotten angry with all of life. He could have started moping and everything else. But Joseph did not allow that what? To bring his faith and spirit down. He continued to be positive in his approach to other people. You remember the story of George Washington Carver? Well, how many of you have ever heard the name George Washington Carver? Because I know we as blacks, we don't know much about our heritage. The only time we even studied or it's brought our attention is during what? Black Heritage Week, and that's in February. And beyond that, we don't do nothing else beyond that. That's it. But anyway, you hear none of that. George Washington Carver, he was a man that was born in slavery, but he was able to, by the grace of God, he was able to come out of slavery. God had given him a good mind And what he did, and I'm going to condense this, God sent him to Tuskegee Institute, where he took a little peanut. I love peanuts, especially cashews. He took a peanut, and out of that peanut, with the mind and the wisdom that God gave him, he came up, we have been told something like about maybe close to 100 different products. What he did, he took the bad in his life, he turned it around because of his faith in God and turned it into a positive thing. And that can happen. Now, this says easy. It says easy, but that can happen. Joseph was of the highest character. In Ephesians chapter 6, and I want you to turn real quickly to that scripture. Turn to Ephesians, that's in the New Testament, by the way. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 7 and 8. And Paul says, well, let me start at verse 5. He says, slaves, obey your earthly parents with respect and fear and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but like slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart, serve wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord, not men, because you know that the Lord will reward everyone for whatever good he does, whether he is slave or free. I'm reading from the NIV, the International Version. When you please God, it doesn't matter whether man is not pleased, God will fight your battle, take care of you, and really in the midst of, he will promote you. What does David say in Psalm 23, at the end of Psalm 23? He talks about the Lord is his shepherd, right? And I shall not want. And then down toward the end, he said, he prepareth what? A table before me where? Does he put it on the outskirts of town? Does he put it in a private room and close the door? He prepares a table before me what? And where in the presence of whom? My friends? My enemies. And then while they are watching, which means they can't do nothing about it, he what? He anoints my head with oil. That is emblematic of God's favor, his anointing on David. The butler and the baker, they had dreams. Joseph could have become better, but he demonstrated faith in God, which brings me to truth number two. An untested faith is a presumed faith. An untested faith is a presumed faith. Now, if you want to use the word assume or presume, both of them refer to what? A faith taken for granted as I think is authentic, I think is real. It is a faith that's supposed to be true without proof. Ah. None of you here fall in this category. So I'm going to take me as an example. There have been episodes in my life where I thought, listen to my terminology, I thought my faith was rock solid. Could nothing move me. Earth, heaven, hell, I was there. But when God started testing me, and it wasn't because God didn't know how deep the roots of my faith went. He already knew, but he wanted me to see, boy, you ain't where you think you is. Any of y'all ever been there? Maybe I'm the only one. Maybe I'm the freak here in this worship moment. God will test your faith in the hazardous events of life. Gold becomes pure gold when it goes through fire and heat. Why? To burn out the dross, the impurities. The impurities rise to the surface and the gold is heavy. It sinks down to the bottom. The impurities are skimmed off to get down to the real deal, the gold. There are a lot of impurities in my life. Now watch this. They ain't going to admit to this. There are a lot of impurities in my life, and you ain't perfect. Because if you were perfect in your faith, you wouldn't be here now. You'd be up there with him. So it lets us know that God still what? Has to work on you and me. There are still some failings in our life. There are some weaknesses in our faith. There are some chinks in our armor. And before God gets us to his perfect heaven, he's going to clean us up. Maybe your patience is not where it ought to be. You thought it was, but it ain't where God wants it to be. Maybe your mouth is not where God wants it to be. I knew I'd get some reaction from that. And it doesn't matter about the communication that comes out of your mouth. If it's not holy, or if it doesn't give glory to God, he's going to work on your mouth. Maybe your mind is not as holy as it ought to be. Maybe you fantasize too much about unholy. Help me, Lord. No, nobody here thinks unholy things. You have pure thoughts all the time, 24/7. Your mind never goes in. Well, let me give an example of how our minds can be deceived and taken into the gutter. When you see an act on TV, a barbaric act, let's take the man, the young man, I think about 2 weeks ago, that went into the school and killed those people and then committed suicide and blew his brains out. What was your feeling? How did you feel? Were you incensed by, or was it that, well, another shooting and they're going to exist, so you just moved on, it didn't bother you? Or were you upset about it? Now, if you were upset, did you get angry? And I'm not talking about righteous anger. I'm talking about unrighteous anger. Boy, if I had had my shotgun, I would have blown the so-and-so and so-and-so out of the so-and-so and so-and-so, blah, blah, blah. You know where I'm coming from. Unholy thoughts. Not saying in the flesh you can feel that way. But now the point is, does God want us to think and respond that way? Because as a man thinketh, so is he. For the thinking fills the heart, and out of the heart come the issues of life. If you think this way, you're going to eventually start to acting, and you're going to start to doing what you are thinking. Why do you think pornography is over $10 billion business? Why do you think that some Christians, some preachers, secretly in their basement have tapes, cassettes, and what they call those big black things, VCR, isn't that what you call it? Yeah, that ain't it. Well, no more. But you'd be surprised what people store. And at night, maybe 12, 1 o'clock in the morning, they tip downstairs and they put it on and they watch pornography. be a preacher in the pulpit, could be a deacon, could be an usher. Now, when I'm here at the church, I'm as holy can be. I ain't gonna tell you that I watch pornography in my home. That's my business. And then I used to tell them, now, that's just between me and God. You're right. It is between you and God. And God is going to judge this between me and God. But what does it do? It destroys your witness. It weakens your faith. And if you can do that, then Satan, what? He can use you in other instances. All he's got to do is just what? Offer a suggestion. Our law system is based upon the fact that a person is presumed innocent until proven guilty. Is that correct? You get that on TV. But in actuality, in our society today, this right is in reverse. You are presumed guilty until you are proven innocent. Is that fair? Not according to our Constitution. But even our government goes against the Constitution. So that's nothing new. We're living, can I use my terminology? We're living in a rotten society. And you've heard me plugging say this over and over again. America, with the decadence that she's in now, she is involved in the same mess that Rome was. Eventually, she's going to destroy herself. And I hope I'm not here to see it. I'm not wishing it on my children, my grandchildren, but I don't want to be here to see it, because there's enough that I see now with my tired eyes. In the final analysis, as we said before, Joseph could have been better, and he could have told, he could have said, this is not fair. But notice, before I get to my last two, notice in the 23rd verse, when Pharaoh takes him out of prison, puts him back in his position, Joseph asks of him a request. Please, don't forget to mention my name.